exciting architecture, dome stadiums on Modern Marvels. Great spectacles can stir the soul. They reduce epic battles into refined theatrical struggles. It is life in miniature, performed for the amusement of the masses, who for the length of the game can share the glory of the victorious without suffering the effort of the achievement.
The stadium concept has its origins in antiquity, in the Greek and Roman periods. Prior to that, games did not exist, and it was the Greeks who built the first stadia for horse racing and so on. And then the Romans, of course, went much further because they used it as a method of pacifying their populations, especially in places like the Roman Colosseum, where they did a lot of killing of people for entertainment purposes.
Early sporting spectacles often climaxed with a big finish for the second place contestant, a practice which has largely been abandoned in recent times. Modern sports are rarely this bloodthirsty. But throughout the 20th century, Americans have been equally passionate about winning and losing. Our fans revel in projecting their dreams into their heroes, imagining it was themselves swatting the hickory against horsehide, to send the tomatoes screaming out of the park, to win a one-way ticket to the record books. Baseball emerged in the 1800s as a rural pastime. It quickly spread across America, jumping all lines of religion, color, or class. The nation became intoxicated by the game of teamwork and forgiveness, in which you can steal a base, make an error, take three swings every turn, run into an open field, and have a crowd roar when you stride home. Religion reinforces our faith in a higher power. The ballpark reinforces our faith in ourselves. In their times, Babe Ruth, Lou Gehrig, Mickey Mantle, and Willie Mays were almost gods. Bats and balls were holy icons. Hot dogs, a sacrament. Home runs, an epiphany. The stadium, a cathedral. Because of cold weather and winter storms, baseball was only played in summer. But even then, searing heat and sudden showers could quickly cut the heart out of a game. Likewise, other spectacle sports like football could also be seasonally disadvantaged, and the cost of building and maintaining large stadiums demanded year-round use. It was a very human notion to consider an artificial environment to house big spectacles from the elements, and it was a very American notion to accept the incredible scale which would be demanded in such a project. A dimension achieved in such accomplishments as Boulder Dam and the skyscrapers of Manhattan. The challenge of a structure's purpose often defines its design. As architect Louis Sullivan noted, form follows function. In putting a roof over a stadium, there would be no place to position support columns without disrupting the action of a game. The answer is an arched roof, which needs no columns because its weight is diverted laterally and supported by the building's walls. Those walls then need buttresses to keep from buckling under the increased load and further dissipate the overall weight. This is not a new idea. The concept has been used for centuries in the construction of Gothic cathedrals, where great height could not be accommodated through the support of columns. The 20th century approach, however, recalls earlier structures based on a dome design. In this situation, the ceiling and the walls were a single unit, and the entire weight of the building flows evenly to the ground, equally distributing the load over its 360 degrees. Likewise, the gravity of the sides meets in the middle, making a center support unnecessary. The shape also results in energy conservation, as thermal waves are both reflected and circulated by the curved interior surface.
The antecedents of the dome is the fact that it's the simplest way of covering a space if it's not too big. And you have the Inuit ice house And the notion of shelter used in buildings made of vegetation, made of wood, sod.
As the appeal of modern team sports continued to grow, so did the need for domed stadiums to facilitate year-round events. The only missing ingredient was money. But America had plenty of that in the second half of the 1900s, especially in Texas. It had been a flat, barren frontier where grazing herds of steer roamed free. Then vast amounts of oil were discovered underground in the 1930s, and the landscape changed. Cattlemen, gunslingers, and outlaws were replaced by a more dangerous breed: oilmen, accountants, and lawyers. By the 1960s, sports fans in hot and humid Houston were demanding an indoor air-conditioned arena, and the Astrodome was born. The Astrodome was state-of-the-art when it became the very first dome stadium, but the self-proclaimed eighth wonder of the world had not worked out all the bugs before it opened in 1965. The first controversy was the giant facility's air conditioning system. During its inaugural season, the visiting New York Mets claimed that the Astros were using Dome's cooling system to create wind currents which helped lift and carry the home team's long balls. Another problem arose from the thousands of giant glass panels in the ceiling, designed to let the sunlight spill into the giant structure. Unfortunately, they provided insufficient light to allow grass to grow on the field. Likewise, looking straight up at the panels created a strange kaleidoscopic glare, a definite handicap for a player trying to catch a pop fly ball. Painting the clear glass panels white seemed to lessen the disorienting optical effect, but the acres of dead playing field grass demanded a clever new approach. The solution was a thick, ruffled plastic mat laid on the hard concrete floor. It was called AstroTurf after the stadium, and its slick, synthetic texture sent many players out of the game with permanent leg, knee, and ankle injuries due to the inconsistent way their cleats would grip the plastic mesh.
There are drawbacks. Physically, I think it beats up players when they have to play on it on a daily basis. Underneath this artificial surface is concrete. There's no padding. It's built into the turf itself. So it is hard, and it does pound on you.
Artificial sod technology had improved a bit by the introduction of Seattle's King Dome in 1971. Management decided on an opaque ceiling instead of Houston Astrodome's glass. But after two decades of wear and tear, the dome's interior acoustical panels have occasionally suffered from a loosening grip, requiring ongoing and costly maintenance. The process of taking down these tiles and blasting away the glue spots left behind is a serious complication. Still, a major stadium can be an attractive device to pump new life into a depressed city. That was the case in New Orleans in 1971 when work began on the Superdome. Stretching over 52 acres of old train yards, it was designed to boost tourism by attracting major sporting, entertainment, and political events. The Superdome featured the engineering marvel of a domed roof as its hook. 20,000 tons of steel raised the dome 273 feet over the playing field, so great a height that if the Statue of Liberty made her home in the outfield, her torch would just scrape the ceiling. The building is so enormous inside that six stupendous television screens are suspended from a center overhead gondola to allow spectators a good view of the action. Cost overruns and inflation helped bring the final price tag of the Superdome to $163 million. It succeeded in amazing the locals and bringing in tourists, but its size and cost overruns resulted in a $5.5 million operating loss in each of its first 10 years. But ill-conceived municipal dome stadiums can also take a political toll. Montreal 1976, home for the 21st Olympic Games, and a whimsical approach to a retractable roof stadium in an environment plagued by harsh winter storms. Here is a structure that is only partially domed, with the balance of the task performed by a gigantic umbrella. 26 cables drape a 50-ton cover over the stadium from the tallest incline tower in the world, over 50 stories high. In 1992, this tent covering collapsed under tons of accumulated snow. The French architect who designed the facility had been unfamiliar with Montreal's winter environment, and hadn't added the weight in his equations. Soon after the accident, the administration of Montreal Mayor Drapeau also collapsed, a casualty of the calamity. Considering the mounting costs and concerns, it seemed unlikely that anyone would completely succeed in the effort to build a dome stadium. But in 1987, the city of Toronto embarked on a bold new approach. Here, simplicity and ingenuity would join hands and inspire the ultimate arena. Only one baseball player has ever hit the roof of the Astrodome during a game. Mike Schmidt of the Philadelphia Phillies on June 10, 1974. Dome stadiums will continue in a moment on Modern Marvels. We now continue with dome stadiums on Modern Marvels.
I've always said it wasn't the worst stadium in baseball. It was the worst stadium in sports. And what they did was take a bad football stadium, make it a very bad baseball stadium.
Exhibition Stadium was the official name for Toronto's Major League Arena, but most fans referred to it as the mistake by the lake.
It was a retrofit of an old football stadium. We built it in the wrong location. We knew that the traffic patterns were awful, the sight lines were awful, but at least it fitted the bill temporarily before we could build what we really wanted to build.
In 1986, the city of Toronto was ready to commit itself to an ambitious new stadium, which would invigorate the downtown area, excite sports fans, and propel the city into the future.
We thought that if we could do something that Houston was able to accomplish, or the city of Seattle itself, we'd be going a long way. As we started down the road of a dome stadium, it became apparent that a lot of the baseball players prefer to play outdoors. In fact, Buck Martinez, one of the Blue Jay catchers at the time, took me off into the corner and said,
"Congratulations on getting a stadium through. I think that's great. But from a player's standpoint, I don't think players are going to like playing indoors."
Well, I guess I was sort of horrified by the fact that here I'd been campaigning since 1969 to build a dome stadium. Here we are getting ready and finally in the 80s to build a stadium. And I was finally learning for the first time that maybe the players didn't want to play inside.
Then I suggested a retractable roof. I said, boy, that would be the best of both worlds, because you have the weather problem in Toronto. You would alleviate all of those concerns. You'd be able to play in the perfect conditions all the time. But when it was nice in Toronto, you could open a door and you would have a convertible stadium.
So we quickly went back to the drawing board and said, look, if we're going to do something in Toronto, we should be doing something really unique.
In March of 83, the government announced that it was going to look into building a covered stadium for the Toronto area. And I went after the mayor of Toronto, Mr. Eggleton, who was then mayor, asked him for the job, and he said, you and 40,000 others.
Robbie quickly joined forces with his old friend Michael Allen, an engineer with the ingenuity to develop a new kind of kinetic building.
Basically, the question that Rod put to us was, do you want to waste a lot of time, a lot of money trying to go after a dream? And we said, well, why not? This is a wonderful idea. Let's go after it. And we originally treated this as, in essence, an academic exercise. Let's see if we can solve the basic problem. How do you get a retractable roof to work for a dome structure and have the roof, when it is retracted, remain on the building footprint and not parked on someone else's property? And we said, what a wonderful thing to get into and see if we can solve that problem.
It was a case of David and Goliath, with Robbie and Alan putting up their own homes to raise the capital to design a proposal which would rival the well-funded competition. But here was a challenge which demanded more imagination than money. They began with sketches which suggested a general aesthetic theme, a curved arcing form reminiscent of classic dome structures. But this timeless approach only solved half the equation.
A dome by itself was not enough, and this particularly came from the baseball crowd, who insisted they wanted to be able to watch baseball in an open air stadium when the weather is nice. You want to sit out and enjoy the weather, have a beer, and enjoy the game.
The answer was as close as the nearest seafood restaurant.
The inspiration was the idea of crustacea, all these shells moving, say, on a lobster or some sea animal of that kind.
Using the appetizing notion of a lobster's hard, reticulating body plates as an inspiration, Robbie and Alan tested their theory through computer simulations. In this way, they could both illustrate and test a totally original concept in a telescoping structure.
Two of these panels move in a linear motion, and one of the panel moves on a circular track. And when the retraction is completed, all of the panels stack one on top of the other in a telescoping form.
From the computer model, a miniature was assembled. Just like early mud huts and igloos, here was a structurally sound unit.
The basic stress flows like water down a stream. It is an arch, and the load flows down through the arch to the supports and into the concrete structure. This roof span is over 700 feet, and the roof structure is about 15 feet in depth. The roof is designed to support about 600 tons. And we could support 30 DC-9s from the roof, providing they could all fit in there. The roof opens so that 91% of the seats and virtually all of the field is open to the sky.
There were concerns that every fan would enjoy a direct view of all the action in a game.
The fans wanted to be as close as possible to the players and vice versa, and that the stadium should have an intimacy.
Once again, computer models simulated the sight lines from every seat in the stadium. And once again, the designers employed a practical test as well.
They had a stadium with a roof on it, and then they would take a lamp around to act like the sun, and they'd watch the shadows inside the stadium. So that's how the process developed.
It had to have a front and a back, and it had to face the sun. It was going to open up to let the sun come in, so it should retract to the north. And when you saw it, its movements should be complex, elegant, and intriguing.
To sell the concept to government officials and decision makers, Robbie and Alan created a sales video which filtered the technical specifications of the project through a light-hearted, family-oriented comedy about a faceless designer of the dome and his children.
Dad, is this thing gonna work?
Even my own son didn't believe. Come over here, kid. You're going to learn everything about this stadium.
The video worked. Robbie and Alan won the construction contract, and now it was up to stadium management to fund the $210 million estimated cost.
And Metropolitan Toronto put up $30 million towards the stadium. The Ontario government also put up another $30 million. The balance was put up, $150 million at that time, by 30 private sector companies, putting up $5 million each.
Ironically, as groundbreaking ceremonies commenced on June 1, 1987, Robbie had to admit that he was less than familiar with the games which would be played in the futuristic dome.
When I got involved in Skydome, I'd never been to a baseball game. I learned what baseball was as if it was nuclear physics.
Instead, Robbie broadened the attitude of the project and gave it a deeper meaning.
It seemed to me that this building was going to be more than just a sports park. It was a multifunctional building. And I coined the word secular cathedral simply to say it was very big and it belonged to everybody.
The ancient Roman Colosseum would fit comfortably within the Sky Dome. Dome stadiums will continue in a moment on Modern Marvels. We now return to Dome Stadiums on Modern Marvels.
The Blue Jays had to open on a given date at a given time, and there was no forgiveness. It had to do it.
From the very beginning, project management focused on building team spirit first and a dome second. A 360-degree club was initiated with hats that kept the broad vision of the endeavor on everyone's mind. A unity of purpose quickly spread through the team.
Ellis Don had a constant crew of about 650 on the site. They worked 20 hours a day, 6 days a week. At the end,
We had about 2,200 people working on the job to bring it to its final completion. We figured that there were around 5,000 people involved in this building.
The intense effort to meet completion deadlines rivaled the extraordinary scope of the undertaking. The dome was designed to be taller than a 31-story building, large enough to house 8 747s, a herd of 751 elephants, or a 32-home suburban community. Even the original Roman Colosseum could easily fit on the playing field.
It was 24 hours a day. We did all the concrete off-site and brought it in at nighttime and assembled it in the stadium.
The basic structure was composed of over 210,000 tons of concrete with 15,000 tons of reinforcing steel. Many sections were prefabricated and trucked in after dark when empty roads could accommodate an endless parade of oversized trucks. It was important to work at a frantic pace because everyone realized that there were seasons that Toronto's harsh climate could slow the effort to an agonizing crawl. It was Toronto's bitterly cold winters which took the greatest toll on construction and on the fortitude of the workers. Many times their fingers were so numb they couldn't feel the tools in their hands. Eight hours a day, or 10 or 12, the brutal elements made progress a painful victory, but a lasting triumph. The steel shell of the dome, covered with a thin white plastic sheeting, would eventually trap the warmth of the stadium inside for the comfort of the fans. And the structure could stand under the strain of unlimited accumulations of snow on top. More than 12,000 person years of work went into the effort. From laying foundations and hand-pounding massive support girders into alignment, to installing 1,280 toilets, 9,000 light bulbs, and 67,000 spectator seats. The roof alone required a 250,000 bolts, but even that couldn't completely reinforce the public's confidence.
Not only did the roof have to work safely, but it had to be perceived to be working safely so that people would have no concern at all when 8,000 tons of steel is rotating and moving around and the game carries on. We had reports in the papers from so-called soothsayers. We had one very important gentleman who had predicted Kennedy's death and a few other events, and he made headlines by predicting the roof would never open, it would never work.
The most emotional experience was the day we closed the roof. We built the roof open, and then we moved panel one to the south end of the building.
Moved very slowly, and we were all up there and touching the roof as it moved for the first time.
The first day it moved, and I had a chance, the opportunity to ride shotgun as she turned from north to south. It was a super day.
It's not every day you see a structure that's 500 feet start to emerge. It was like being born from the rest of the structure as it came out.
Grown men were crying. I mean, this was a very magical moment.
It was a very, very touching, moving experience because there were so many people had said it wouldn't work, and this was the first manifestation that it would indeed work.
Ironically, work was nearly completed when attentions finally turned to an important missing element.
We ran a great contest naming Skydome here too. We had 150,000 entries, we had 12,000 different names, and we had 2,000 Skydomes.
For us, it was either always the dome or the condome, because when we were designing the building, of course it didn't have a name. We suggested condome to our client, and there was some... There was a lot of chuckling.
So we narrowed it down with a group of 16 judges to the word Skydome. We had the premier of the day reach into a drum, pulling out a name. Now the prize was two tickets for life. I leaned over to the premier, I said, I hope you pick somebody really old.
The winner was Kelly Watson, a young school teacher from Ontario who now enjoys lifetime seats, valued at over $10,000 a year. But this big prize was only part of the cost overrun.
The stadium didn't come in on budget because we kept adding things to it. We added the hotel, which was $110 million. We added a health club. Our initial boxes were only going to be 90. The demand said we should add more of those, so we got up to 161. The total cost of the project was $570 million.
Like a massive mechanical flower, Sky Dome blossomed into a multi-purpose center designed to service the world's biggest crowds. It included 25 fast food outlets featuring the largest McDonald's restaurant in North America. A 350-room luxury hotel is part of the structure, as well as a movie theater and a $13 million television studio.
3 years and 8 months to do everything in a building that went from being just a stadium into a multi-use facility with a hotel in it and a lot of other things. Considering the size of this job, there were very, very few accidents during the construction of the building. There were, unfortunately, some fatalities after it was finished on some cleanup work. There were two accidents, both of which killed two people.
Under the spinning and reticulating ceiling of Sky Dome, the energy and dreams of a city had been focused on one spectacular goal. But as opening day approached, everyone was secretly wondering, would the performance match the promise? Engineers estimate that the Sky Dome will have a lifespan of approximately 300 years. Modern marvels will return in a moment. We now return to Modern Marvels. June 3rd, 1989, Toronto gathers for a first look at their new half-billion-dollar stadium with a grand opening celebration as large as the stadium itself. In an explosion of light and sound, Sky Dome was born.
As part of the opening ceremonies, all the workers came in and paraded through the stadium and received a standing ovation from the crowd that was here.
The ironworkers, the electricians, the designers and plumbers were joined by over 5,000 performers, including a chorus line of 750 dancers. A joyous sea of humanity covered the field to usher in a new era in stadium spectaculars and see the dome open for the very first time. Was so anxious for the experience, no one complained that a storm passing over the facility actually caused everyone to be drenched in a warm summer rain.
Everyone got wet because it happened to be raining at the time, but what a wonderful event.
I think the media would have been really critical had we not opened the roof. We also had six parachute jumpers outside, and that would have been very difficult for them if we hadn't opened it. So we did open it.
When that roof opened up for the first time, and really in the middle of a rainstorm, my goosebumps got goosebumps. There was a tear in my eye, and to this day, I will never forget the emotion of trying to explain to my three sons how the Sky Dome was built, and they were watching a bit of Canadian history and Toronto history really take place.
Opening night of the Sky Dome was more than a celebration of a new era for sports in Toronto. It was an opportunity for the city to salute the men and women of the community who brought that vision to reality.
I think in about 1988, there was a national competition that I read about to design a workers' recognition mural for the Sky Dome. And it was the first time that I'd seen a call for entry for a piece that was going to recognize workers. The need and desire of the money men who built. The stadium to recognize the men and women who built it. And I think that it's always been very important for workers to say, I built this. And here, they have the opportunity, their signatures are right on the piece. I have 1,800 names in this piece. We discovered a method of a photo emulsion method of actually getting their signatures and transferring them onto glass and sandblasting it into black flash glass. I think the day that the Skydome opened and they came up and they looked for their name was a very exciting moment.
Two nights later, it was the Blue Jays' turn to take flight in the new stadium, although preparations for the first pitch were far from complete.
We are very excited about being the team to open the Skydome because it had such a build-up in terms of being the first convertible dome, so to speak. And I'll always remember coming out to the ballpark that day about 1:30, walking out here onto the field. The tarp wasn't down, there was no dirt on the field, the fences weren't up, and we said there's no way we're going to be able to play this game tonight. And sure enough, about 4:30 came around and they were making progress. They said, hey, batting practice is canceled, but we still think we can start the game on time. About 6:30 they said, well, there's not going to be an infield practice, but we still think we can start the game on time. About 7:15, they're putting down the dirt at home plate, putting in home plate. The fences are just being completed, putting up, and sure enough, at 7:35, the first pitch is thrown. I happened to be the first batter facing Jimmy Key. Didn't swing at the first pitch because there was way too many flash bulbs going off. I had trouble discerning the ball from the light, and eventually in that at bat hit a double to left center field. So a small part of Skydome history, but one that I can say that I'm a part of for forever, really.
Great joy can come from the most humble of desires. To sit in the stands with a cold drink and a hot dog. To cheer the boys of summer as they run the bases. To glance up at the open sky and feel the fresh breeze. And consider that men may be able to go to the moon. The one real lasting accomplishment of a man is to be able to swat one out of the park.
Pitcher's mound, which is interesting, is actually, it's a big fiberglass tub floating on some water, and if we're going to go to football, we let the water out underneath this tub, and the whole mound disappears down to the ground, and then we put a cover over it.
The design of the Sky Dome holds many secrets, but the biggest mysteries were buried at the site and uncovered before the first bulldozers plowed the soil.
History told us that this was really the site of a huge garbage dump. There's probably a better way to put that, but that's really what it was. In the old days, they were trying to reclaim the waterfront. Of course, they needed real estate. And one way to do that was to dump anything, virtually anything that wasn't still alive, they would dump into the water on the water's edge. And so what we have here is a time capsule of what people were throwing out back in the, well, as early as 1850, 1860.
Building permits from the city of Toronto demanded that the landfill site, which would support the Sky Dome, be studied for historical significance by an expert.
And you have to get a licensed archaeologist. It's not just some guy off the street with a shovel that does it. It's somebody who really knows what they're doing. I guess the most interesting of all the bottles is one that's not just visually interesting, but to your nose as well, because it's a mustard bottle. And we're talking about not yesterday's mustard, but mustard that's over 100 years old. And yet you can still smell traces of mustard as you try and crack the mustard jar. There are some tools, as you can see in here, but the question is, how did it get to be garbage? Did some guy say, I've had enough of this, and throw it because he bought a brand new one? Or did he lose it? I mean, is he still wandering around somewhere saying, where did I put that thing? And this is a French cannon. We don't know how it got here. One extreme, perhaps, is that it came here in an attempt to bolster the armaments that we had when we were defending against the Americans. Many people don't realize that during the War of 1812, Toronto was attacked by the Americans. And for 5 or 6 days, the Americans were in charge of this community until they saw the price of gasoline and left. But this cannon conceivably came here in order to help us defend against the invasion. And now it's become part of your experience at Sky Dome. You just don't come here to watch a ball game or a football game. You can actually learn about the history of our community, which in my estimation is almost as important as winning a World Series.
But for those who are more interested in today's games than in yesterday's garbage, Sky Dome features a stupendous technological miracle.
It's 30 feet high by 110 feet wide. It wasn't until 2 years ago the largest screen in the world. The Jumbotron is a large video screen. It's not a solid piece. The board is actually made up of 67,200 of these things, and these are called Trinolites. And each one of these trinolites contains two picture elements. And this element are three strips of phosphor, blue, red, and green phosphor. When you're very close to it, like if you're only 3 or 4 feet away from the screen, it just looks like a bunch of colored dots. And of course, jumbotrons are hundreds of feet away from the fans. When you get that far away, you can then see crisp, clean, clear video pictures. And if you take a magnifying glass and look at the television screen at your house, you'll see these same strips or dots of color. We can't show live action on the jumbotron, and it's not something that's unique to this facility. All Major League Baseball teams have to abide by the rules, and the rules very clearly stipulate that no video screen is allowed to show live action while the game is in progress. If you as a batter are trying to concentrate on the ball coming from the pitcher's hand, you're distracted by a large video image of yourself in motion above the pitcher's head, it could distract your concentration on that 90 mile an hour fastball. Also, they don't want to see that over the shoulder shot from center field, which shows the catcher giving the signs, because then everyone in the ballpark would know what the next pitch is going to be.
But the Sky Dome has used its jumbotron screen for more than just baseball.
There are over 250 events in this building on an annual basis. We've had auto races in the building. We've had bike races, dirt shows, concerts. And in addition, just recently, we showed the final game of the 1994 World Cup on the jumbotron, and 17,000 local fans came down to the building to watch the final game between Brazil and Italy on the jumbotron.
Ironically, one of the biggest events at the Sky Dome didn't happen at the Sky Dome. October 1992, the Toronto Blue Jays capture the World Series in a triumphant final game in Atlanta. But in their hometown, nearly 60,000 fans packed the stadium to watch the win on the giant jumbotron screen. It is a surprising twist to the end of the 20th century that spectacular arenas can achieve popularity simply by showcasing a spectacular television set. But the Toronto Sky Dome has discovered that spectacle has a powerful allure, whether it's a live contest or simply a stupendous presentation. The first World Series ever played outside of the United States was played in the Toronto Sky Dome. Modern Marvels will return. We now return to Modern Marvels.
It takes about 20 minutes to open the roof once you've pushed the button, but there's work beforehand before you can get to that point. You have inspections. All roof areas have to be inspected. It takes five people, anywhere from 4 to 6 hours, and they look at every area, every catwalk, every tunnel area. They're looking for anything that might interrupt or cause the roof not to function properly.
Every time the Sky Dome opens, there is an investment of time and money.
I'd say we're running between $1,000 and $5,000. You open the roof up for 2-3 hours, the sun gets absorbed into the concrete and the seats and everything, you shut the roof later, you spend the next 8 hours trying to get rid of that heat that you've collected while the roof was open.
The real trick in operating the 10,000 metric ton dome is being able to predict perfect baseball weather.
We're in the central control room for roof operation. It's in this room we have the equipment that actually monitors and operates the roof, as well as a radar system that allows us to go online with our weather company, our weather contractor, and decide whether or not we want to operate. This particular screen is the Toronto radar, and what you see, the different colors, is the different amount of precipitation in this actual rain area. So the darker the color, the more water you're getting. And it's giving us a 40% chance of rain and various other information that we need to know.
Once the decision is made to open the dome, the process is automatic.
Okay, we've finished the inspection on the east and the west sides. We'll be ready to open in 10 seconds. Stand by.
Opening the largest retractable domed stadium on Earth requires the coordinated effort of 52 separate 100 horsepower engines, pulling the enormous panels along tracks.
Uh-huh. These are the main indicator lights for when we're operating the roof. Once we've pushed the open or close buttons, which are here, a series of operations happen up on the roof, and you want to see things happen in a specific order. That's what these lights let you know. Up here we have our position, skew, and speed indicators. The speed of the panels is 70 feet per minute, and skew is the difference in the position on one side of the panel to the other side.
The opening of the Sky Dome is an elegant and mesmerizing technological dance. Like many objects of enormous beauty, the Sky Dome's poetry of form and graceful movements suggest a lightness, an almost playful spirit in concrete and steel. That spirit was, in fact, built into the structure, a solid reflection of the team spirit which conceived and constructed Toronto's Dome. Toronto is a Native American word for gathering place. As a civic project, Sky Dome magnifies the meaning of the city's name. This dome stadium is a modern marvel for its size, its design, and the powerful gatherings it has hosted, particularly in 1993 when the Toronto Blue Jays took the World Series crown on the Sky Dome field. Still, there are people in the world who have never been to a baseball game. They've never taken a seventh inning stretch or called the umpire a bum. But anyone who has been to the park knows something about the human condition that can never be written on paper or put in a bottle. It is to roar with the pack, snarling at one instant, then cheering the next as a 9-ounce ball carries the crowd to heaven. Stadiums are not just places where people go for the games. They do not simply house the playing fields in a confined space. Instead, stadiums are a way of keeping the everyday world out to maintain the purity of the sport. Here is sanctuary and communion that nourishes the soul and allows the common person to face yet another week of the real world. When a city builds a stadium, it is creating a multifaceted jewel through which the world can see the community's best nature. Wanting to dome this jewel in a protective top seems an obvious endeavor, designed to defy the elements, to allow the games to go on all year round. But the construction of a dome that opens and exposes its prize inside is a wonderful gift from Toronto to the world. Over 50 million people have been inside Sky Dome, and once touched by this magic, you never leave. Part of you remains, joining the countless other spirits whose song is the chorus of the universal passion of sports. This is automatic.
Okay, we've finished the inspection on the east and the west sides. We'll be ready to open in 10 seconds. Stand by.
Opening the largest retractable domed stadium on Earth requires the coordinated effort of 52 separate 100 horsepower engines, pulling the enormous panel.
Open or close buttons, which are here, a series of operations happen up on the roof, and you want to see things happen in a specific order. That's what these lights let you know. Up here we have our position, skew, and speed indicators. The speed of the panels is 70 feet per minute, And skew is the difference in the position on one side of the panel to the other side.
The opening of the Sky Dome is an elegant and mesmerizing technological dance. Like many objects of enormous beauty, the Sky Dome's poetry of form and graceful movements suggest a lightness, an almost playful spirit in concrete and steel. That spirit was, in fact, built into the structure, a solid reflection of the team spirit which conceived and constructed Toronto's Dome. Toronto is a Native American word for gathering place. As a civic project, Sky Dome magnifies the meaning of the city's name. This dome stadium is a modern marvel for its size, its design, and the powerful gatherings it has hosted, particularly in 1993 when the Toronto Blue Jays took the World Series crown on the Sky Dome field. Still, there are people in the world who have never been to a baseball game. They've never taken a seventh inning stretch or called the umpire a bum. But anyone who has been to the park knows something about the human condition that can never be written on paper or put in a bottle. It is to roar with the pack, snarling at one instant, then cheering the next as a 9-ounce ball carries the crowd to heaven. Stadiums are not just places where people go for the games. They do not simply house the playing fields in a confined space. Instead, stadiums are a way of keeping the everyday world out to maintain the purity of the sport. Here is sanctuary and communion that nourishes the soul and allows the common person to face yet another week of the real world. When a city builds a stadium, it is creating a multifaceted jewel through which the world can see the community's best nature. Wanting to dome this jewel in a protective top seems an obvious endeavor, designed to defy the elements, to allow the games to go on all year round. But the construction of a dome that opens and exposes its prize inside is a wonderful gift from Toronto to the world. Over 50 million people have been inside Sky Dome, and once touched by this magic, you never leave. Part of you remains, joining the countless other spirits whose song is the chorus of the universal passion of sports.